Tom. That's convex.
U's.
And then you associate to such a U and a measure. So what do I want to say? I want to say I want to take a case where n is equal to m, because I've never thought about this in other cases. And I want to look at this thing, and I want to use that to define and so this is like the S-Mongin pair measure of the function u. And yes, if I have a sequence of u's that are S-convex and converging, there's S-convex and shows enough compactness that it doesn't really matter. So converging, say, pointwise almost everywhere, then on a subdomain, you'll get uniform convergence almost everywhere, and then these measures here will converge weakly. And things like that are used in the regularity theory, but in order to have regularity, you need more assumptions on S than just twistedness and non-degeneracy.
More.
Yeah, so, I mean, for convergence, you'd be fine, but to go further, you need... So there's this Mod-Schrödinger-Wong theory that, again, requires N equals M. It requires S to be twisted, non-degenerate. And so as in the problem that Javier was talking about, the problem is basically to get U to be C1. And then once you have U in C1, then C1 alpha, you also have to work hard to get C2 alpha, and then standard elliptic Schauer theory takes over. But anyhow, to get U to be C1, they need to make the following sort of assumption. There are different ways to write it. A geometric way of writing it is that if you look at this thing, you can think about that as being like a metric tensor on the product manifold. It's not positive definite, but the non-degeneracy ensures that it's non-degenerate. And so you can look at the associated Riemannian curvatures to this metric, and you need those to be non-negative in order to progress with the regularity theory. At least on two planes of the following form. Where P and Q are orthogonal for this metric. And of course, so curvature is involved taking two derivatives of the metric tensor, and so this is really some kind of condition relating third and fourth. It says that the fourth derivative of S controls certain products of the third derivatives that are put together in a geometrical way. Other questions? And you also need some kind of convexity. So for example, if I try to map a connected source to a disconnected target, I'm going to get singularities. And so basically the kinds of things people assume are that the target fills M minus, and moreover that that so this is some subset of Rm, and you want this to be convex for every x. And usually, and actually, a lot of the theory is done under symmetrical conditions, so you would assume the same thing for every y with a y derivative here and m plus on the left. Okay, so any other questions? I'll try to pick up from where I left off yesterday. So let's see where I left off yesterday. So I should have, my definitions were not so fantastic apart from notationally, but at least we came up with a rather nonlinear differential equation, integral differential equation, and I expect it to hold f at least y almost everywhere. And so let me recall, at least if y is a point where v is differentiable, then I will have these containments that the S sub-differential of V at Y is going to be contained in second differential. X1 of YQ is the set of X such that X2 So I had some integral, I think it was in this form. Hessian of V in the numerator. Set G something like that, and then there was this theorem that I closed with, and it had three parts. So S should be, I guess, C2 twisted non-degenerate, and V is always going to be S convex. And then part one said, U and V optimize. If and only if G3, the non-local guy, right. if G1 or 2 of V and V is sufficiently smooth, I don't really need smoothness up to the boundary, but then if I only have smoothness on the interior, I need to augment it with an extra condition. So if I have a solution to either of these local equations, then this guy optimizes. And finally, if I have U and V smooth enough, optimal, and if these sets here are connected, then I have the corresponding equation. Right, so I wanted to say a word about the proof, the proofs. For the first part, I'm going to use that I had this pointwise identity for the Jacobian, and then I want to use I want to use the coarea formula. So let's see, there's a map. So whenever I have U and V S conjugate pair, whether or not they optimize, I want to look at the good points. So let's say Y star will be the set where V is twice differentiable, and right, T is going to be, I'm always under these hypotheses of S is twisted and non-degenerate, so T is going to be Y composed with U. And so I want to separate F plus into its restriction to this set and its complement. And what do I want to say? I want to say that that the push forward of at least this part of the measure under T is quite nice. So so V is smooth on Y star, and that's telling us in this game there's always some duality between smoothness on one side and strict convexity on the other side, or strict S convexity on the other side. So the fact that V is smooth on Y star is telling us that U is in some sense strictly convex on X star. And so that's going to tell me that the push forward of F plus star is absolutely continuous with respect to the Lebesgue measure on the target space. And moreover, that I have a nice formula for this.
it's run on nicotine derivative, its density, at some target point y,
is given by the thing that we want.
I'm going to say g3d of y.
And basically, this is sort of so what are we would like to if t was a
if t were Lipschitz, and Jacobian derivative were never too small, so it was bounded away from zero,
then this would follow from the coarea formula, and we sort of saw that in the first lecture. And the point here is that we sort of have something that's countably Lipschitz, and so you can do this using a countable decomposition. Because we're on this set where Hessian of V is smooth, and we're on the preimage of that under T, that's telling us maybe the Jacobian isn't bounded away from zero, but it's bigger than zero. And so by decomposing x star into countably many pieces, I can have it bounded away from zero on each piece. So decompose where t restricted to xi is Lipschitz, and Jacobian if t restricted to xi is bigger than, let's say, 1 over I. And then on each piece, I can extend t to something that's globally Lipschitz. I can apply the coarea formula, get what I want on each piece. I'll have an integral over here, but it will involve the intersection of, so on each piece, I'll have something like, I guess I'll have my f star plus is going to have to be decomposed into a corresponding collection of pieces. So let me call this like f plus star I. Apply the coarea formula to that. And then sum on I. And then once I have this lemma, it reduces, the theorem becomes very elementary to deduce from this lemma.
So basically, so for example, the proof of one. So I'm in a situation where the lemma tells me I have something like this, and my question is this really equal to f minus or not? And so in the one case, if this holds, then this thing has total mass 1, and so this measure has mass at most 1, but if its image has total mass 1, this measure has mass 1 as well. And then I want to see that in that case U and V actually must optimize, but then I'm in a situation where T pushes forward F plus to F minus, and we know that and T has this special form. So that it can only be an optimal map. And similarly, U and V have to be optimal measures. I mean, optimal functions, rather. Right, so that's one direction, that's this implication. And conversely, if U and V are optimal, so I have, again, my dilemma, I have that this thing is equal to T push forward of this F star. And so that's less than T push forward F of of F, which is equal to F minus. And again, this can't, so this has total mass 1, and this has total mass 1, so we must have equality almost everywhere. And a similar sort of thing happens in case 2. Right, so I know that G1 and 2 dominate G3. So in case 2, I'm in a situation where I know that G3B is less than G1 and 2B, and by assumption, that's equal to F minus. And the lemma tells me that this is equal to and on the other hand, the hypothesis that V is smooth up to the boundary tells me that that
y star is everything, which implies that x star is full mass, so f star plus is equal to f plus. And and now this is mass one, and this is mass one, so the inequality must be an equality. And then and that reduces me to situation one says that when equality holds in this relation here, then U and V are optimal. So that's point two. And finally, point three. So now I'm willing to assume that these guys are optimal, and I also want to assume this, and I would like to conclude that the local equation, and not just the non-local variant, hold. And so somehow I need connectedness of these sets in here to do that. So let's see. Basically, my U and V are both C2, and so that implies that my T, remember T is defined by Y composed of VU, so this guy is C1, and because of the non-degeneracy, Y is C1, so this thing is C1. That's full rank. So basically, what I want to show is that I already know from point one, when these guys are optimal, I already know I have this equality here. So one implies minus is equal to g3d of y, and I know that's always less than V1 and 2 V of Y. And so what I would like to get equality here, I would like to show that the S subdifferential of V of Y is not just contained in, but is equal to Xi of Y V. All right, so I want to show equality holds here. So this is my xi of y. And notice both of these sets are relatively closed. Like to show that this guy is relatively open and not empty, and then I will have equality because of the connectedness of this thing. And non-emptiness holds for almost every y, because almost every y is the image of some x under t. and that x will be in this set here. So this holds f minus almost every y. And that's why in the end I'm going to get a conclusion that holds f minus almost every y. And to get that this is relatively open, I'm going to use this the fact that t is continuously differentiable. So, so locally, so let choose some x in this non-empty set. Locally, in the neighborhood U of x, we can find coordinates such that this smooth full rank mapping looks like the canonical submersion. Right, so taking the neighborhood smaller, if necessary, I can make sure it looks like a ball in these new coordinates. And so basically what I want to look at is, so if I pick some y over here, at least locally, that's going to look like point y cross rm minus n, again, intersect u. And of course, t inverse is always contained in the subdifferential. And subdifferential is contained in xi. And x2 is smaller than x1, so that's contained in x1. But because of the non-degeneracy of S, we said this thing was a submanifold. So this thing is a codimension and submanifold. So this intersection here as a whole is like an open ball. And on the other hand, this intersection here is an open ball as well. And so these containments need to be equalities. And so that's that gives us the equality here. And so I should maybe have some, I should show you some examples again. So imagine, for example, so we talked about circles yesterday, discs yesterday, so let's think about ellipses or ellipsoids. So take, take M plus to be uniform on an ellipse. And so M minus is going to live on the boundary. And again, there's a case where I can guess what the answer is, and that's the case where I take each point in the ellipse and I send it to the nearest point on the boundary. And so on the axis of the ellipse, there's some ambiguity. My picture's not great, but so points on this axis want to go both ways. And so take u minus to be the image of u plus, where p is projection to nearest point. So somehow something very singular is going on here. And what happens in this case is if you take a y on the boundary like this one, then for this projection, v is probably going to be 0. And u is whatever. So again, I'm thinking of taking s to be the restriction of Euclidean constants, this ellipse and its boundary. I think u is something like the, it's something like minus the sine distance to the complement of the ellipse. So again, the u is going to be singular, the v is nice and smooth. So the S subdifferential of v at this y here is going to look like, I'll draw in some color. It's going to look like that set there. And so that's going to be my x3. And on the other hand, my x1 is going to be the entire segment. And the x2 is going to be something in between. Except that the endpoints here with the x, the x2 is going to coincide with the x3 at these endpoints because this is a focal point of the ellipse. So in this case, the non-local equation, G3, is going to hold, but G1 and G2 are going to fail to hold, and that's really reflecting the non-smoothness of the solutions. So for this example, G3 equals holds, but not G1 or G2. So there's a strict inequality here. And maybe with strict, except that these two endpoints were saturated. So what's an example where G1 or G2 might hold? Minus to be surface measure on some, part of the boundary, and take the mu plus to be like this, and then as long as if the fiber is now mapping to each plane on the boundary here, don't intersect each other in the support of mu plus, then you're in a situation where G1 holds. So if these fibers intersect each other in the interior, it's hard to find the singularities, and these local equations are not going to hold. But when they cross the entire support of U plus, then you're in a good situation. And so this would be G1 of E equals F minus will hold. And what's a situation where G1 won't hold, but G2 will take, you know, a spherical annulus or something like that? So if this is my U plus, let's take it uniform on the spherical shell, and then try to map the whole thing to maybe a bigger sphere with the same center. And in this case, so for a given point y on the boundary, my set x1 is going to look like this. So that'll be my x1 ui. My set x2 is going to stop, I guess that's x3. And my set x2, in principle, would stop at the origin. But this part doesn't matter because mu plus isn't supported there. So from the point of view of mu plus, x3 and x2 coincide. And so that's going to be a situation where G2 is going to equal minus. But this will be strictly less than G1 of B, because when I do this integral, I'm going to take that mass over here that doesn't go to this point y, and rather goes to that point. So this guy's non-local, and so it's hard to talk about. I mean, I don't know what it means for this to be elliptic. It's a fully nonlinear, very non-local equation. On the other hand, these two equations both are elliptic under suitable hypotheses. So at least degenerate elliptic. So what does it mean to be degenerate elliptic? It means I want to linearize around a solution. And it's going to be a solution that satisfies this S convexity property. And then you remember that the S convexity when you have this inequality here, this equality here, it implies this inequality. And it's exactly this inequality of this object here, the positive definiteness or non-negative definiteness of this matrix that appears under the determinant that's telling you these equations are elliptic when you linearize them. And that's more or less straightforward to show in the case of G1. Because then this domain here doesn't depend on Hessian of V at all, it only depends on gradient of V and Y. In the case of G2, things are more subtle because when you want to try to linearize this thing, the dependence on the Hessian is both up here and down here. And what saves you is that even though the domain varies, when you vary the Hessian of V, it only varies where this determinant is vanishing. And so the vanishing of the thing where the domain varies is telling you that it doesn't, but only the derivative with respect to this part counts. Okay. So in the time remaining today, I'm going to specialize to the case and so this is the case where more or less the ODE becomes, or the partial differential equation becomes an ordinary differential equation because Vy is a function of a single variable. And what we saw in the first lecture was that when both the domain and the range were one-dimensional, and if S was non-degenerate, in the sense that you have an inequality, and I think I actually wrote it backwards in the first lecture, then there was an exact non-decreasing solution. And what I would like to be able to do is sort of duplicate in the case where M is bigger than 1, but the range is still one-dimensional. I would like to be able to construct solutions again. Now, I can't always do that, but I can do it when the local equation holds. I can't do it when the non-local equation holds, because then, in principle, there's a singular set, and I can't say exactly what the singular set is going to be in most cases. But if the singular set isn't there, then I can say exactly what things are going to look like. You know, if, for example, if I'd ask you to map a uniform measure on the interior to the ellipse, not to this projection, whatever it is, but to a uniform measure on the boundary, then it's not, well, okay, maybe there's enough symmetry with the ellipse to guess where this singular set is going to be, but if it was not exactly, if it was not exactly symmetric, you wouldn't be able to find it. Great. So by the way, gosh, so what I've described so far today is joint work in progress with Brendan Pass. And what I'm about to describe is a paper that you can find on the archive with Chiappori and Pass. And actually, although this PDE becomes an ODE, because the determinants go away, I don't really want to work with this ODE in this form. I want to work with an integrated version of it. So let me tell you what wants to do. So for example, suppose I have some cloud. This is my M plus, and I want to map it to some interval on the line. This is my mu minus. What am I going to do? So I fix some y over here. And I want to know what portion of this cloud did that y come from. And so let me introduce the set so this will be the set of all x such that this is the y derivative of s, it's now a scalar, less than 2. So that's some set. And notice that this set is a monotone function of Q. So the bigger Q is, the more of M plus this will enclose. And so it's sort of easy what to do. You have a certain amount of mass to the left of Y. And so by varying Q around in here, I want to select the Q such that for every Y, select of y such that the integral of mu plus, so let me give this a name, so the integral over that set of mu plus minus the integral up to y minus equals 0.
And because H is monotone in Q, there will such a, and it's okay, it'll be continuous if assume U plus doesn't concentrate. On any hypersurface. And again, and S is non-degenerate. So non-degeneracy of S in this case means that the X gradient of the Y derivative of S doesn't vanish, and that tells you that this is going to be, if S is C1, or C2 rather, that this is going to be a C1 hypersurface. And I don't want you to charge this thing, and then H will be continuous in Y, and I can always find a Q of Y that does this. I probably want to assume U plus doesn't have atoms. So that makes H a continuous function of both variables. And once I found that Q of Y, what you might expect is that if this is now X less than or equal to Y cube Y, what you probably expect is that the optimal map should take the frontier here to this point Y. I don't want to listen to you. Now this is where the trouble starts. So now take some Y prime, and that has maybe more mass to its left. And so go back to your domain, and now look at the sets X less than or equal to Y prime and Q. So this is a different set of interfaces, right, that cross the domain. And so you pick out the one where you pick out the Q of Y prime, where the mu plus mass of this equals the mu minus mass to the left of Y prime. And there are two possibilities. So then you get a picture like this. Say that's when I superimpose this picture on this picture, there are two possibilities. One is that the curves don't intersect, and then I'm in good shape, because then my definition for t on this frontier doesn't conflict with my definition of t on this frontier. And the bad case is that I get this picture here. And now I'm trying to set t equal to both y and y prime at this position, and that's somehow telling you that you haven't done the right thing. And so basically, in this case, the local equations aren't going to hold, and you need to go to the non-local equation. And what I'm telling you is that if these things never cross each other, then the local equations are going to hold and you can solve the problem. So we're going to make that an assumption, basically. So there's a little, what is the little caveat? The little caveats are, if you want to do this in full generality, QY may not be unique unless U plus charges the whole set. If there are gaps in the supportive U plus, then there may be a largest Q that satisfies this and a smallest Q that satisfies this. So
Let p plus minus y be the largest and smallest q of y such that h, largest and smallest q such that h of y cube equals 0. And so what's my setting? So I'm going to take m plus and m minus the connected open sets. And I'm going to have these hypotheses, u plus and minus, concentrated on hypersurfaces. And I'm going to have S, C2 or C1 is enough. But non-degenerate, and you have to be careful, what does non-degeneracy mean if you're not C2? So you use the Clark sub-differential applied standard in non-smooth analysis. And then point A is that Q plus and minus Q minus exist and are upper semi-continuous. And so my definition is going to be, I'll say that S and U plus minus are nested, this combination. If and only if the mapping from Y to this subset is non-decreasing. So in other words, the more I take y prime to the right, the larger the corresponding subset over here. And moreover, I need to be strictly non-decreasing in a certain sense. And whenever y and y prime have positive mass between them, then I want the largest such set at the smaller y to be strictly contained in the smallest subset at the larger y, where x strict here means that in the definition, where the definition's gone, I replace the inequality by strict inequality. So you know this is going to be some closed set and this is going to be some open set, and I want this closed set to be contained in the open set. And so I guess I have time to state a theorem and then quit for the day. If you think about it, you can understand that the vanishing of H is basically like you took the local ODE that we had before for x1 and you integrated it with respect to y, and then you get that h vanishes. So then what's the conclusion? So if s and the data are nested, then q plus equals q minus holds mu minus almost everywhere, and t as above is well defined mu plus almost everywhere, and by we kind of constructed t so that it would push forward mu plus to mu minus,
and it uniquely minimizes the Kantorovich problem, the Monge-Kantorovich problem. And finally, if so this is like B, and point C is that if the support of U is connected, so if there are no if there are gaps in the target, then I'm obviously going to have discontinuities in the map. But if there are no gaps in the target, then T is equal to T bar, where this holds U plus almost everywhere. So, and T bar is a continuous map.
So minus.
T is essentially, sorry, what?
New, new minus.
Yeah, sorry, new minus, thank you. I'm mixing the notation of the paper with the notation of the talk. Right, so T is essentially a continuous map in that case. And that seems like a good place to stop.